from frying oil to flying oil. Can the 747 take flight? Let's find out, guys.
There's a sample of the sustainable aviation fuel that actually came out of the tank from the airplane.
It's not as strong as the Jet A. This feels like a diet version of the Jet A fuel, actually. But it's certainly the same clarity I can see. It's very transparent here. It's all look like very clear. The big question is, can aviation go green? So with the sustainable aviation fuel, and the 747 has four engines, but one of the engine is the 787 Trent 1010 engine. So that's where the sustainable aviation fuel is gonna go into that engine to prove if that engine on the 787 can take 100% sustainable aviation fuel.
Hey, this is Charlie, all the way from Derbyshire, all the way to sunny Tucson. This is our Rolls Royce 747 flying test bed, and I'm about to give Sam Chewy a tour on it.
What a pleasure, my first time walking on board a 747 test bed. My favorite airplane, 747. Look at that, experimental Tucson.
Hey, welcome inside the Rolls Royce flying test bed. This is the nose of the plane underneath the cockpit here. We have everything removed. It gives us more space for maintenance.
So today we're going to be flying the new SAF fuel, sustainable aviation fuel, on the flying test bed. So which is really good. Today we're going to be doing some sharp accelerations and decelerations to see how the engine behaves. We're going to switch the engine off and switch it back on again and look at the progression of the relight to see how that behaves with the new SAF fuel. So the pilots are going to be doing all those kind of maneuvers, and right here I'm going to be looking at the engine in a bit more detail. I'm going to be looking at the different shaft speeds. I'm going to be looking at how the igniters behave during the relight. So yeah, it should be a good flight.
Are you confident that this airplane, the engine can use 100% SAF to perform all the duties?
Yes, on the Trent 1000 engine, we've done some ground testing to de-risk the SAF running on a Trent 1000. So we're very, very confident that we can get this this engine running and up in the air.
Isn't this cool? The whole section has only one seat here, and I'm the only passenger in this giant section in the middle of the 747. And see here, we still have the old Sony camera.
Oh yeah,
like
yeah.
The projectors.
The projectors are old, and then the screen will be here. And then
on the test bed, you have movies. What are these stuff here like?
So this is when we modified for the, we have an electric start on the Trent 1000 engines that we have to put on wing. So this aircraft had to be modified specifically for electric start. And then we kept seats in the back, therefore ballast for the aircraft when they take off.
Okay.
And obviously nobody sits back here when we do our flight testing, because there's no drop down oxygen. And we're now in the bulkhead area at the back.
Look at this.
You don't see that on a plane very much. And then up here, Sam, we have the flight recorder. Spiral staircase. They don't have them anymore, so it's kind of cool. Let's go, man.
It's been a while. I remember myself coming onto one of these spiral staircases. It's beautiful, classic birds, just love it. Oh my gosh, there's actually business class seats on it. Wow, look at this. My one doesn't quite recline, but I'm really happy here because I think the green color business class seats kind of give away the origin of this airplane. I think it came from a very prominent Asia Pacific Airlines. So you guys can guess and look it up, the history of this airplane. I'm with a legend here, Captain Buzz Nelson. who actually flew to China before I was born. He flew to China before the diplomatic relation were restored in 1973, delivered one of the first 707 to CAAC.
First flight with a Trent 1000 engine with SAF fuel. We're expecting to have a normal flight. Don't expect any kind of surprises with the engine and the fuel. It's going to be a rather intensive flight. We have a lot of test conditions to do, so we're going to wring out the engine and the fuel combination. The route of flight will be from Tucson to the east. We're going to climb to a medium altitude, about 20,000 feet initially, to perform a few tests as we head to the east to western Texas. The entire flight we're estimating about 4 hours flight time today.
I love that jet fuel smell when a taxi passed me. I'm not sure it's the Jet A or the Sustainable Aviation Fuel.
And when lights are on. And we got inboard on. Running your steering and we'll go up. Okay, here we go.
I love seeing that 747 Classic rotate in 2021. So it's gonna take the 4 hour test flight going over to West Texas, and hopefully it will come back. And let's see how the performance using sustainable aviation fuel. Can aviation go green? Let's find out. So after the plane took off, we came back to our office here. The engineer's monitoring the flight progress on the flight aware. Right now it's doing about 24,000 feet climbing over, just over New Mexico. The only 747-200 in the sky, isn't that amazing? How's it performing right now? Why is it still a little slow, 360 miles per hour?
Currently the aircraft is at a slower speed, replicating some of the experiments that we're gonna do during the 3 hour sortie. We'll be accelerating the aircraft, decelerating the aircraft, changing altitudes on the aircraft just to replicate the test that we want to do.
You know, I would have loved to go on a flight to feel the acceleration, deceleration, but I'm not an engineer. That's I can fine. Only wait on the ground now. So while the flight is out at testing, I have an expert from Boeing focus on the sustainability, he's going to explain to us what exactly is sustainable aviation fuel.
So I'm holding a sample of sustainable aviation fuel. It's the same as normal jet fuel, except it comes from sustainable sources. It can come from any number of different things. We tend to focus on waste-based feedstocks in aviation, things like used cooking oil, fats, oils, and greases. In the future, forestry waste, municipal solid waste, agricultural waste. Really, any type of carbon source, any kind of biomass can be converted into fuel, provided it's made sustainably.
But is the SAF really sustainable in the sense that there's not enough supplies out there?
It's a little bit of a chicken and the egg problem where there's low supply and therefore the cost is high. So we need to get the scale up in order to drive the cost down. But we can't get the scale up until the costs come down. So we really need some government incentive support to help bridge the gap between today's supply base and the future supply base so it can be economical for the operators and the producers.
How many millions of gallons of SAF we're producing right now?
Today's production volume is around 5 to 10 million gallons per year. But you know, we're looking forward to scaling that up rapidly over the next decade or so. The Biden administration has set a goal of hitting 3 billion gallons by 2030 for the US, and that would be a great accomplishment for us.
So Sam, we've now completed the test plan. We're descending back down to 20,000 feet to transit back to Tucson.
I saw a very graceful touchdown, the 747-200. So we're coming down to the hard stand, try to meet the plane now. So I can't wait to hear from you guys. How did that test flight go?
Today was successful. We were able to complete all the test points as we set out to.
So we used the SAF fuel throughout the entire mission through the Trent engine today. We did some sharp accelerations, some decelerations, so the pilots did a snap with a throttle to full throttle and then back to idle again. It's all looking really good. We've got some great data. We're going to look into that data in the next few months, and it's really looking promising for SAF fuel.
Tell us about today's flight.
Well, I have to say it was very routine. It was just exactly like a normal, any other flight that I've done on this airplane. I've been flying this test bed for more than 10 years, and today's flight was exactly like all the others.
So what did you do to number two during the flight?
Well, the orange color is there just to indicate and make it easier for the flight crew to know that in fact is the Trent engine and not all the others, because it's easy when you grab all four engines and you want to do a particular test with the Trent. We set the Trent engine up for the condition they want to test, and then we use the RB211s to maintain the altitude and airspeed that we need to do. You can see the engines throttles will look sort of like this all over the place. They're never lined up.
What's this little string on this?
Well, that's just a reminder that when we come in to land, we want this engine to be at idle only because it makes the flight a little more efficient. We want to cool the Trent for 5 minutes at idle before we shut it down. So typically we don't use the Trent during approach and landing. We just make a three-engine approach and landing using that. And that's not because it wouldn't work fine, but then if after landing we have to idle it for 5 minutes before we can shut it down. And we'd already be back at the parking spot before then.
Every test flight is a little step closer. I am looking forward to the greener future of aviation.